Hello everyone. So friends, in this lecture we will discuss about the top-down approach. So in our previous lecture we saw that how we can solve a problem using dynamic programming with a bottom-up approach. And in this lecture we'll see that how we can solve a problem using top-down approach. So what is top-down approach? So this method is also called as memoization. So what it means is that in this method we break the large problem into multiple sub problems. Each of the sub problems are solved and solutions are remembered. So by remembering the solutions, we treat it as a memorization, and the term given to it as memoization, which means that something we are remembering to reuse it later. So how does it work is, if the sub problem is solved already, we simply reuse the answer. So here you can see that we are solving the sub problems and its solutions are remembered. So later point of time, if that sub problem comes again into picture, we simply reuse the remembered answer. Or else what we do is, we simply solve the sub problem and store the result, which simply means that we are remembering the solution somewhere. Thus it memorizes the solution of the subproblem to avoid the recomputing the value if subproblem is encountered again. So friends, in our previous lecture we also saw that when we are doing recursion, we can solve the problems by breaking it down into multiple subproblems. And if those subproblems are encountered again, then instead of recalculating it again, we simply store the solution of that subproblem, and when those subproblems are encountered again, we simply use those solutions rather than computing them again and again. Thus it brings the optimization to our recursion. So here we'll see a program to find the nth Fibonacci number using top-down approach. So here you can see this is the algorithm where we need to find the nth Fibonacci number. And here we are also passing an integer array, which will simply help us in memorizing the solutions of the subproblems. And we will frequently check this integer array to see if those subproblems are solved already or not. So if those subproblems are not solved, we proceed ahead, we solve those problems and we store it into this integer array. And if the subproblems are solved already, we simply reuse the solution. So this memo array help us in remembering the solutions so that we can reuse the solutions if the same subproblem is encountered again. Thus it provides the optimizations to our recursive solutions. So friend, as this is the recursive solutions, we'll also see the demonstration using the call stack. So let's say we want to calculate the fifth Fibonacci number. So we'll simply pass an empty array with the size is 5 plus 1, which is 6, because we know that the indexes of array are starting from 0, and this memo table will store our Fibonacci numbers from 1 to 5. So the value stored at the 5th index will be our answer. So therefore we are creating an array of size 6. So in the first step it would look something like this, that we have an array of size 6 having the default value is 0, and on the call stack you will see the fib method has started its execution with the value of n as 5 and with the integer array shown here having all the values as 0. So friends, here you can see that as we are using the top down approach, we are starting from the 5th index, which is the topmost index, and then we are going to the bottom. In the bottom up approach, we started from the 0th index and we went till the 5th index, but here we are starting from 5th index and we are going to the bottom. So here we are simply checking if the value at 5th index is 0 or not. So here you can see the value at 5th index is 0, which in terms of this problem, it is not solved. So the condition in if block comes out to be true, and we need to calculate this value. So first we check whether the n is less than 2 or not. So here you can see the value of n is 5, which is not less than 2. So the condition if block comes out to be false, and the else part gets executed. So here we also know that in order to calculate the fifth Fibonacci number, we need to do the sum of its two previous numbers, which is the number stored at third index and the fourth index. So in order to do that, we simply call the fib function again, passing in the memo array and the value is n minus 1, because we need to calculate this value and this value and then do the sum of these two values to get this value. So here you can see that now this fib function is called recursively, and we are leaving this fib function on the call stack at line number 6. So we'll simply add the line number 6 here, so that later we can come to know that from which point we need to restart this fib function. So we have left this function, and on the call stack there will be one more fib function with this memo array and the value of n is 4, because we are passing n minus 1. So 5 minus 1 gives 4. So this function will be executed with n equal to 4. We check that whether value at 4th index is computed or not. So we know that it is equal to 0, therefore it's not computed. So then we go ahead and compute it. 4 is not less than 2. So the condition in if block comes out to be false. And now in the else block, if we want to compute the value at 4th index, we need to compute the value at 2nd and 3rd index, do their sum, and get the value at 4th index. So friends, here you can see that first we will need to calculate the value at 3rd index. So we'll again call the fib function, passing in the array, and the value is n minus 1, which is 4 minus 1 equal to 3. And we also know that we have to leave this fib function at line number 6. So we'll simply store the line number here. And then the fib function will be called again. And on the call stack, you can see we have left this fib function and we have started executing this fib function with the value of n as 3. We check whether the value of 3 is computed or not. So here you can see the value of n is equal to 0, therefore it's not computed. We check whether n is less than 2 or not. So 3 is not less than 2. And here, in order to calculate the value of the third Fibonacci number, we need to first calculate the values of its two preceding numbers. So we again call the fib function, passing it the integer array, and the value is 3 minus 1, which is 2. And we are leaving this function at line number 6. So the fib function will be called again with the value of n as 2. So on the call stack there will be another fib function with the value as 2. We will see the value at second index is computed or not. So here it is equal to 0, therefore it's not computed. We check whether 2 is less than 2 or not. So 2 is not less than 2. So we'll start executing the else part. And here also, in order to calculate the value at second index, we need to first calculate the value of its two preceding numbers, do their sum, and get the value of second index. So first we'll go to the n minus 1 part, which is 2 minus 1, which is equal to 1. So here now fib function will be called again. So we are leaving this fib function at line number 6. So we'll store the line number here. And then fib function will be called again with the value of n as 1. So on the call stack it would look something like this. We see that value at first index is computed or not. So here you can see it is equal to 0. Therefore it's not computed. and we proceed ahead. Now we checked whether n is less than 2 or not. So here you can see the n is less than 2 because the value of n is 1. So friends, here you can see that why we have provided this if block. So we know that the Fibonacci series starts from 0 and 1. So we are simply checking that whether n is less than 2 or not. If it is less than 2, we are simply storing the value of n to the memo of n. So here value of n is 1. So at the first index, we are storing the value as 1. So it would look something like this. So 1 is stored at 1th position. So after this step, finally we return the value stored at first index. So friends, here you can see that why we are returning this value 1 here, because we called this fib function from this fib function and we left at line number 6. So at line number 6 we had to calculate the value of 1, and then we have to calculate the value of n minus 2 and then do the sum of these two values to get the value at second index. So therefore we have calculated the fib of n minus 1, which is 1. So we are simply returning the value 1 from this fib function to this fib function. So it would look something like this. This fib function will be removed from the call stack and the call will go to this fib function, and we also know that we had left at line number 6. So we'll start executing from the line number 6. And whatever we return from this method will be stored in the left, which is nothing but 1. Moving ahead. Now here you can see that when we are executing this fib function, the value of n is 2. We have computed one of its previous value, which is n minus 1. And now we have to find the value n minus 2 so that we can do the sum of these two values and get the value at the second index. So therefore now we'll again call the fib function to calculate the n minus 2th value. So here you can see that now we are again calling fib function and we are leaving this fib function in line number 7. So we'll simply update the line number 7 so that we can come to know the later that at which line we left this function. So we updated the line number. And now this fib function will be called with the value as n minus 2, which is 2 minus 2, which is equal to 0. So it is called for fib of 0. And here we check if the value at 0th index is computed or not. So it is equal to 0, therefore it's not computed. We check whether n is less than 2 or not. So 0 is less than 2, therefore condition if block comes out to be true. And finally we'll store the value of n, which is 0, to this memo table at index 0. So here at index 0 we'll simply storing the value as 0, because we know that the Fibonacci series starts from 0 and 1. So if the value of n is less than 2, we simply store that value into its index. So now we'll simply return this value because we need to get this value here. So this fib function will be removed from the call stack and 0 will be returned from here. And we know that we had left at line number 7. So we'll start executing from the line number 7. And this fib function has returned a value 0. So we'll store that value in the right. So 0 will be stored at the right. So friend, now you can see that in order to calculate the second Fibonacci number, we need to do the sum of its two previous numbers. So we have got the sum of its two previous number as 1 and 0. We'll do the sum of it and we'll store at the second index. So 1 plus 0 is 1. So we'll simply store the value 1 here. And then from this fib function, will simply return the value stored at second index, because value of n is 2, which is nothing but 1. So 1 will be returned from this method, and this method will be removed from the call stack. And now we'll start executing this fib function, and we know that we had left at line number 6. So we'll start executing from the line number 6, and we also know that we had returned the value 1 from this fib function. So 1 will be stored in the left integer variable. Moving ahead, now we have calculated the n minus 1th value, which is this, and we need to calculate the n minus 2th value, which is this, in order to get the third Fibonacci number, because value of n is 3. So we have computed one value, we need to compute the other value. So here the fib function will be called again with the value as n minus 2, which is 3 minus 2, which is 1. And we know that we are leaving this fib function in line number 7. So we'll simply update the line number 7 here. So the fib function will be called again with the value of n as 1. Here now we have to calculate the value of the first Fibonacci number. So now here you can see the advantage of using this memo table. We are checking that whether value at first index has been calculated or not. So this sub problem has been encountered again, because we have already calculated the value at first index, which is 1. So by providing this simple check that whether memo of n is equal to 0 or not, so we have already calculated this value, so we don't have to recalculate it again here or here. So therefore, storing this result of the sub problems gives us an optimization over the recursion here. So instead of calculating it again here, we are simply returning the value stored at the first index. So we are simply returning memo of 1, which is 1. So this fib function will return the value as 1. And we know that we had left at line number 7. So we'll start executing from this line. And as the return value is 1, the value stored in right would be 1. And finally, we can come to know the third Fibonacci number by simply doing the sum of its two preceding values, which is 1 and 1. And we'll simply store that value at the third index. So 1 plus 1 is 2. So we'll simply store the value 2 at the third index. We move ahead, and we'll simply return the value 2 from this fib function. So this method will be removed from the call stack, and it will go to its previous fib function, which we had left at line number 6. So we'll start executing from the line number 6. And we know that we had returned the value of 2 from this fib function. So it will store in the left. And now we'll simply calculate the fib of n minus 2 to get the value of the right part. So on the call stack, we are leaving this fib function at line number 7. So we'll update the line number 7. This fib function will be called again. And on the call stack, we will call fib with the value as 4 minus 2, which is 2. Moving ahead, we'll simply check in this table that whether this sub problem, which is fib of 2, has been solved or not. So we are simply checking this memo table, and we are simply checking at the second index whether the value is 0 or not. So here you can see we have already solved this problem and stored its result. Therefore, we don't have to recalculate it again. So we are simply returning the value stored at the second index, which is 1. and we are returning the value 1 from this swif function to this swif function. And as we know that we had left this swif function in line number 7, we'll start executing from the line number 7. And then we'll simply store the value returned from this function, which is 1, into the right variable. Finally, we'll do sum of these two numbers and we'll store it in the fourth index, because in order to calculate the fourth Fibonacci number, we need to do the sum of its two preceding numbers, which is at index 2 and 3, stored in left and right. So 2 plus 1 gives 3. So we'll simply store 3 at the fourth index. And finally, we'll return the value 3 from this swif function to this swif function. And we also know that we had left this swif function in line number 6. So we'll start executing from the line number 6. We return the value 3 from this swif function. We'll simply store it into the left integer variable 3. And now, in order to calculate the fifth Fibonacci number, which is our actual main problem, we had calculated one of its preceding value, which is n minus 1 here. We just need to calculate n minus 2th value, this value, and then we can do the sum of its two values and get the solution to our main problem. So here, we'll again call fifth function, passing in a value as n minus 2, which is 5 minus 2 equal to 3. And we are leaving this fifth function at line number 7 now. So we'll update the line number 7. So this fifth function will call with the n as 3. And friends, here you can see the advantage of this memo table, that we have already calculated the third Fibonacci number, because value stored at third index is not equal to 0. Therefore, we don't have to recalculate it again and again using this code. So finally, we'll return the value stored at the third index, which is 2. And we'll simply return from this method and go to its previous method. And we know that we had left at line number 7, so we'll start executing from the line number 7. And as 2 is returned from this fifth call, we'll simply store it into the right integer variable. And then as we want to calculate the fifth Fibonacci number, we got the fourth Fibonacci number and the third Fibonacci number stored in left and right. We'll do its sum and we'll store at the fifth index. So 3 plus 2 gives us 5. So 5 is stored at the fifth index. And finally, from this fifth function, we'll return the value stored at the fifth index, which is our actual answer. The fifth Fibonacci number has the value of 5. So we are simply returning the value 5. And this method will be removed from the call stack. And hence our problem is solved. So friends, here you can see that we started from the top, we moved to the bottom. Therefore, it's top-down approach. And we also know that we have used this memo array, which helps us in memorizing the solutions of the sub-problems, so that those sub-problems, when encountered again, are not recalculated again. So we are simply storing those sub-problems result here, and when those sub-problems are encountered again, we don't have to compute it again. We simply take that value from this memo table and reuse it again. Therefore, using this memo table, to our normal recursion, we are providing an optimization. And we also know that dynamic programming is nothing but the optimization to our recursive problems. So friend, in this lecture we saw the top-down approach of dynamic programming, that how we can use that approach and solve a complex recursive problems efficiently. Now let's go to Eclipse and see the demonstration of this algorithm. I hope you like this video. Thanks, have a nice day.